Today we are very lucky to have Professor Cherukupalli, who is a Brooklandian professor of geology at Brooklyn College. And he has taught at many different levels at Brooklyn College, as well as many PhD students at the Graduate Center. An author of hundreds of books and articles.
Papers.
And he is also a research associate at the American Museum of Natural History. And in 1995, he was also nominated as an outstanding educator by the American Association of Petroleum Geologists. Please welcome Professor Nehru.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Tam. And I don't know whether to call you guests or students or researchers, whoever you are. I'd like to just show you a few things before I get started with the talk. This is a map of the world, and I'm sure you can identify yourself as to where you are. That's North America, South America, Africa, and so on. And if you look at the time frame on the left-hand side top, shows 0, 200, 180, 140, 120. It's telling you how long ago the world was like this. Today is 0. And if you go backwards in time, all the way up to 200 million years, we geologists always count things in millions. We are millionaires. Sometimes we are billionaires. You will see a little bit later on in this talk that we not only are millionaires, but we are also billionaires. So this is just for fun. Why is it that the whole world seems to be breaking up? As a matter of fact, we are now in a broken condition. And we will talk about that a little bit more, but we can close that. Yeah, we can just exit out and then open the other one that we were just looking at. This is a fun globe. Again, before I get started with the real talk, if you just press the center button and then rotate it, there we go. We can rotate the globe in any fashion you like. Can you see? You can take Australia and turn it sideways. This is really a fun globe. Not only you can do that, if you come and click on this show cities and show labels, if you just click on those two, click it, and then all the cities will disappear. You don't need to worry about where any city is unless you're interested in going there. And if you cut out the labels, any other labels might be there can also disappear. We're really looking at the real world. And these are the oceans, and these are the continents, and that's, believe it or not, Africa looking sideways. If you are, could you turn it right side up? Yeah, it takes a little doing to do that, right? Very good. Now, can anybody tell where you are? Just among your try for yourself. Where am I in this world? This is India, where I come from. Turn upside down, okay? If you are at the North Pole, if you're looking down, that's the way India would look like. And I don't know your name, but Kari has made me look upside down, and so could you make me right side up, please? Okay. Oh, by the way, it also shows you the snow cap. That's the the ice cap we have, and then there's another ice cap underneath. And if Tommy can rotate herself properly, we can see the ice cap underneath as well. The Arctic, the Antarctic, the whole bit. And then I just would like to show you a few fun things with this. If you go to Earth from Space, next one up, yep, click that. And that's what we are looking at. This is the Earth from space. The next one is hot zones. Which places are hot is what is being shown. You can see the color differences. You can show the cities and the labels now so that they can understand where we are. Some places are quite hot, some places are not so hot. The color tells us which are the real hot stuff and which are not. One other thing is the fire zones. If you want to put the fire in there, where is going to be the, okay? It doesn't show too well, but let's try the drained ocean. In other words, if we take away all the water from the ocean, what does it look like? That's a dramatic picture that we have not known back in the last century and in the early part of this century. We did not know that the oceans look like this. This is something that has been discovered after the World War. As a matter of fact, when they were fighting the Germans, they were fighting with the submarines, and the submarines had to navigate under the water, and they had to make sure that they don't go and hit some rock and then get broken up. So they had to map the oceans, meaning that they had to find out where the valleys are, where the hills are, and all that. And they started doing this for a military purpose. And so they did not tell us the information, only the military had it. But they were supplying the submarines all this information so that if somebody was traveling over here, they could avoid all these hills, okay? And then go only to a little bit deeper parts. You can see that the center of the Atlantic, could you move it over a little bit to the left? Well, very good. So you see, between North America and Africa here and Europe over there, we have the Atlantic, and the Atlantic is full of mountains right in the center. If you are traveling by airplane, most of the airplanes go at night, so you can't see anything, but people want a window seat, right? Please give me a window seat as though they can see everything. They can't see a thing. But they like the window seat. I like the aisle seat because I don't need the window seat, so I can get up and walk around. Anyway, that's not the lecture today, but you cannot see any of this. And also the people who were traveling by boat also did not see any of these things. They thought the ocean is ocean, and if you go to the center of the ocean, it should be the deepest part. That is the old idea. But now we know that the center of the ocean is not the deepest part, it is quite shallow. As a matter of fact, once in a while, there are islands that pop up. And there's a place called Azores in the Atlantic. And if the airplanes needed any kind of a fueling or some problem, they just stop there and then refuel or get their engines properly fixed, because it's very difficult to change the engine while it's flying. You know? That's what the pilot told us a long time ago. You have to stop the engine before you can change it. Anyway, that's just a joke, in case you didn't get it. So this is a fun kind of a globe, which we can rotate, do all kinds of things. So we can just get rid of this and get on with the real talk. Okay? So you can close this. You can go here. No, you can actually close the whole thing. You don't need to keep it in the background. Yeah, you can go to this one and open it. Yeah, very good. So, here we are with the real talk. And the title that we decided for this talk would be Beyond National and Ethnic Boundaries, the Inside Story of Mother Earth. Of course, my name and my department and Brooklyn College, we have to advertise for that, so, okay. So the next one, we just hit the next button over here. There's the ear. The T missing from the earth. Oh my God, terrible, terrible. We'll have to put the T in later on, but for now, we just have to have an ear full of this talk. So you get the picture, all right? You have seen this many times. Go to the next one, please. No. See, the TH is coming here. The earlier was there and the TH is here. Please go back. Ah, now, what we need to do is to click this And all that I need to do is this. Okay. Let's go this. You see, from next time onwards, we don't need to worry about this. Just for now, we'll go with this. Okay. Talking about some boundaries, I thought it might be a good idea, because you remember the title of the talk was boundaries, ethnic and other kinds of boundaries. One of the kinds of boundaries we talk about is the political boundary. Everybody is familiar with this. So if I put up a map of the world, there are too many countries, except the United States is the big one there. And then, of course, the China is there, is also quite big. And there is India, and Africa is all broken up into lots of little pieces. And then Australia is still intact. But you can see that we have political boundaries, which everybody can understand. There's no problem there. Next one. Now we talk about ethnic boundaries. That was another part of the title of the talk. So I thought I'll show you a map of the ethnic boundaries. And as far as ethnic boundaries are concerned, I wanted to get a definition for what is an ethnic boundary. So I went to look at the definition for an ethnic boundary, and I found ethnic groups is the name given now. They don't call them boundary, they just call it ethnic groups, and identified by common cultural traditions or heritage. In other words, if they have something in common, whatever that may be. Maybe it's a religion, maybe it's a language, maybe it's some habits, whatever it is, that's an ethnic group. And based on the number of different kinds of ethnic groups in any given country, we have a different color. Like, for, I don't know how well you can read this, less than 50, 50 to 69, etc., 98 or more, and then there's no data. So we can go to these colors, and we can see that there are more number of ethnic groups in Italy, of all places. I don't know why. I cannot understand. And in this part of the Middle East, and this is Bangladesh. I don't know why there are so many ethnic groups in Bangladesh. This is news to me. I have to ask somebody in the sociology department. Maybe next time when a sociology person comes here and gives a talk, we can ask questions and then we find the answers. But this was very interesting. When I was preparing for this talk, when I found all these things, oh my God, I'm going to talk about all these things. I don't know the answers. I'm going to look terrible. But then, it's better to look terrible rather than say,
I think it's the other way around, that 98% of the population is the same ethnic group.
Oh, is that what it is? Oh, well, thank you for straightening me up. See, I was standing upside down so far. Now you tell me 98% is the same. Percent of population accounted for by largest ethnic group. Whatever that means. Okay, let's look at the next one. Next slide. You just press the button and it should go. Huh? It's stuck there? How about the... We have another map of boundaries, religious boundaries. Well, I'm not an expert on all religions, but I know something about Hindu religion over here, and I'm sure you know something about Buddhist religion, and it's over there, and we have religions of different kinds. I don't want to go through the whole map except to mention to you that when we look at religions, we have a different boundaries. So depending upon what we ask for, the boundaries are different. Let's look at another boundary. Okay, next one. I thought we'll show you some conflict boundaries. There's a problem boundaries. I don't want to go into the details of what the problems are in the Middle East.
I don't want to talk about problems in Asia, Russia, China, India, Pakistan. There are too many problems. But these are some of the locations where you might find some problem type of boundaries. Next one. My favorite location, because I come from there. So I had to show you this little detail, because I have to show you that I went to school over here. This is where I went to school. I studied. But I was born in an area somewhere over in here. Not in here. This is where I was born, and then I was brought here and I went to school. And my parents live over here now. And I have worked in many places. Being a geologist, I worked from down here all the way up to here, except I didn't go into Kashmir. I was afraid of going to Kashmir because it's a conflict area. So I don't want to go there and get killed. I want to live. So I came to the United States and I'm still living, okay? The next one. There are other kinds of boundaries. For example, geologic boundaries. Okay, what exactly is a geologic boundary? There are volcanoes, there are rocks of a certain age, there are rocks of a different kind. All these things are labeled according to the time at which these rocks were manufactured in the world. You remember I was showing you earlier that not all materials are of the same composition, and during certain times certain kinds of rocks get manufactured, and according to that we can show that the world is made up of different kinds of boundaries. Again, we cannot get away with this boundary business. There are time zone boundaries. I didn't even bother to show you. You're all familiar. This is Eastern time zone boundary. That's the Western time zone boundary, South Central and all that. But let's move to the next one. Then we have more boundaries between the Earth and the atmosphere. All right? There is the Earth. And then if we go up to the atmosphere, we can see there's a troposphere, stratosphere, mesosphere, thermosphere, exosphere, and all these spheres. You know, I'm sure if you studied a little bit of geography, you'll be familiar with all these various spheres. Just wanted to show you that as you go up and up, not only there is less amount of oxygen, but there's more amount of names. And we have jet streams and all that kind of stuff around 250 miles. By the way, you should be familiar with meters, kilometers, miles, yards, all kinds of stuff. If you want a simple conversion, about 1.5 kilometers is 1 mile. All right? 1.5 kilometers is 1 mile. And so you can keep converting things in your head. Pretty pictures. Next one. Oh yeah, there's another boundary we have between the Earth and the water. Okay, and that's sometimes quite bushy. Sometimes there's nothing there, but that boundary is there. And shoreline, going to beach, summertime, wintertime is too cold, and all this other stuff happens. And there is a lot of important information that we gather by looking at this zone. And we can talk about it another time, but for now I would like to simply mention that this zone is quite important for us. Okay, next one. This is another ocean continent boundary. If you are looking at the difference between continents, which are made up of real rocks, and the oceans, which is made up of water, that's what most people believe. But in reality, the oceans are also made up of rocks. If you go below the water, there's rocks. And these rocks are not simple. They're quite complicated. And they have lots of structures. As a matter of fact, you can see all over here, there are ridges over here and over there. And over here, all these kinds of up and down kinds of stuff is quite complicated. And I just wanted to mention to you that
between the ocean and the continents, the boundary is not quite simple. It does get complicated. And this boundary has changed within the last 250 million years. You remember the first slide where things were going apart and coming back and all that kind of stuff? This has happened. This is what we call continental drift. The continents were drifting away from each other because they were all together at one time and then they started drifting. Let's go to the next one. Here we are with the continents drifting away. Pangaea is the name given to the supercontinent. This is going back about 240 million years ago. And then at that time they were all together. And come to about 60 million years ago, they have taken these positions. And then today, which is the latest one, everything is quite far away. Now, if this keeps going, can't go too far because the world is finite in size. And if you keep moving this like this and then go on, and then they got to hit someplace else. We'll see where they will have to actually collide. This happens. Like, for example, might as well mention to you that India is in a collision course with China. It's not a real political kind of a collision course. This is a geological. No control over it. We just have to live with it. And that's how the Himalayas are formed. The Himalayan mountains, which are the tallest in the world, they're formed because of the collision course between India and China. And that's how they're formed. Next one, please. I've been talking about all these times. 250 million years ago, zero time, or 60 million years ago. There is such a thing called a geologic time scale. We take all these materials of the Earth and then classify them according to the time span. The original classification of all these Earth materials or rocks is based on fossils, what they find in rocks. These fossils have been studied for a long time, and on the basis of the evolutionary trends in fossils, we find that they're given different kinds of names. All these names are based on some locations. Cambria is in England, and Precambrian, everything before Cambrian is Precambrian, and things like this. Cambrian, Ordovician, Silurian, Devonian, Mississippian, Pennsylvanian, Permian, Triassic. Oh yeah, Jurassic became very popular. But actually, geologists have known the Jurassic times well before Spielberg found out about it. I don't know if he ever took a geology course, but he made big on the Jurassic Park. Jurassic was famous because the dinosaurs were, actually the Triassic, Jurassic times, the dinosaurs were quite popular. By the time we come up to the Cretaceous time, this is when they became extinct. All the dinosaurs were killed. There are theories as to why it happened and all. Perhaps another time when I come here, I can tell you that story. But for now, let's move on. All right. What do we know about the Earth? This is a question that I would like to pose and try to answer. And at the end, I would like you to come up with your own conclusions as to how much we know about the Earth. I don't want to give you the bottom line answer, but I would like to take you through a series of pictures to tell you how much we know about it. So far, most of the stuff that you've been looking at, I made you believe that yes, we know everything about what I'm talking about. But don't let that fool you. Because simply because I have a title and I've been teaching for 35 years or 48 years, no, 38. 38 is more correct. Doesn't mean that I, you know, I tell the whole truth, nothing but the truth and all that. Sometimes you just have to make believe that we know everything. Otherwise, people won't believe. So, I'm trying to show you what we know about the Earth, okay? We know that the Earth is layered. It's got different kinds of layers, and you can see the different kinds of layers are all shown over here. This is the center of the Earth, and this is just a slice taken from the Earth. And then we have different parts to it, which are labeled over there, which are also given here. There's the inner core, the outer core, and then we have the mantle, and then we have the surface waves, and basically, how do we know that the Earth is layered? It's not the same through and through. Everything is changing as we go deeper and deeper. Well, we have friends. If we don't know how to do things, we get hold of friends. And the friends, if they know, they do things and then tell us, and then we tell everybody. Okay, we don't tell who told us, but in this case, I'm a nice guy, so I'll tell you. The geophysics friends, they're the ones who did all this work, and they found out that if they send earthquake waves or seismological waves, these waves travel at different speeds as they go inside, and then they get reflected, and then they come back up. So you can pick up the wave here. You can set up a bomb kind of thing, or some kind of a charge, we call it, and then the waves travel. This is one simple way in which these waves travel. There are more complicated waves, but to make a long story short, by studying the wave velocities in the different parts of the Earth, we find that they change. And this change can be interpreted in terms of what kind of material. This is what is done by the geophysicists, and then they come and tell us, we find different kind of material. What kind of material? We don't know. You tell us. This is the speed with which the thing travels. Okay, so we give them some name, and then they're happy, and we're happy. The next one. These are the different kinds of layers that I was showing you earlier. We give them names like oceanic crust, continental crust, solid core, liquid core, and then the mantle. And then more recently we have also used another term called the lithosphere. All these names mean something in terms of the properties they exhibit. Okay, you know the difference between solid and liquid, that's simple enough. But what is the difference between continental crust and oceanic crust? Very simply, the continental crust has a density of about 2.7, and the oceanic crust maybe about 3.1, 3.2. There's a slight difference in the density, which is because it has different kinds of rock material. The lithosphere is a name that was coined only about some 40 years ago. To me, 40 years is a very small time. You know, we deal in millions, so 40 years is nothing time. So it was coined only recently, and I'll tell you about it a little bit later. But for now, if we cut open the Earth, this is what it would look like. Okay. Now, next one. Oh yes, the story behind our quest for knowledge about our own planet. I put that title there because there are two things. We have the oceans, which occupy about 65-70% of the surface, and then we have the land. Okay, well, land we can climb if we have energy. It might get a little cold if we go on top of the world, but otherwise it's climbable. If we want to see what's under the water, then we have to have some kind of a machine like this. We can take you underwater, and we cannot get out because the pressure is tremendous, so you can only look through a little bit of a window. There are some windows in the front, there are some windows on the other side. They just have to look through them, take pictures, and then come back and tell us this is what they saw. So these are the two kinds of business that we are in terms of knowing more about our planet Earth. We can climb, or if we want to see, remember all the various layers I showed you, the geophysicists decided on all those layers indirectly. It was not done directly, it was done indirectly. So if we want to go down and take a look, actually, and that was one of the aims of the scientists, back when I was a student, a professor in Princeton University, Columbia University. I'm talking only about the universities that you're familiar with in New York City. And then there are other universities that joined, and they said, well, we have to actually go down and take a look at the rock inside, because nobody has seen it. So they said, we need money. We need money to make a drill hole. These are drilling machines. They put a hole, and then they drill, and bring out something. So they applied for some money. And next one, please. And they said, well, we don't want to drill too much. We'd like to drill where the uppermost layer is very thin, because the geophysicist told us that the uppermost layer is thick under the continents, is very thin under the oceans. If we go back two slides, Yeah, this is fine. Although this doesn't show it, the oceanic crust is quite thin, only about maybe 5 or 10 kilometers thick, whereas the continental crust is quite thick. It can go up to maybe 40 kilometers. So we don't want to spend all the time going through 40 kilometers. We can just go to the bottom of the ocean and then drill a little bit, because they found that at the bottom of the crust, before they go into what we call the mantle, the speed of the waves increases quite a bit. And so there is a big jump in the speed, which tells us that the material is very different. So we were curious to understand what kind of new material do we have down there. We'd like to find out. So we wanted to drill. We got the money and everything. If we now go forward. Yeah. We found out that the Marianas Trench, this is in the Pacific Ocean, this is the deepest part of the ocean. How deep is this? Something like 36,000 feet below the surface of the ocean. Remember, how deep is 36,000 feet? If I gave you the number for the tallest mountain in the world, which is only 29,000 feet plus, it's growing a little bit. But the tallest mountain in the world, which is in the Himalayas, is only 29,500 some number. Whereas this one is 36,000. In other words, this is the tallest one, and this one is this far down. And said, well, here is very thin, so we can just go drill a hole and then go to the mantle and take a look. But then, how do we go 36,000 feet and then put a hole there? That is an engineering feat. So they didn't know, so they started talking to the engineers and so on. So they got a little bit of money, and they were getting ready to drill a hole and all that. And let's see what is coming up next. Well, and then while these guys got all the money and they were getting ready to do this and that, we have a Cold War between the United States and Russia. Many of you are not perhaps born at that time, and Professor Tam might remember all this I am showing you. There was something called a Sputnik. This is a kind of a machine that was sent into space. It's like the space probes now. This is quite common now, but in those days, even to just get off the ground was big deal. So the Russians, they did it. They sent the Sputnik. This is back in the 1950s. And that was the time I just first came to this country, and I was a student at Columbia, and I heard about the Sputnik and all that. So they were trying to tell us, oh, this can get away from the ground and go around the world and all that kind of stuff. Wonderful. So what else can it do? Next slide will tell us that, just about that time, I have to tell you this story because it's very important. Nixon was there, and Kennedy wanted to become the president, and Nixon wanted to become the president, and they both were debating each other, and this is the era. For the first time in the United States, the two presidential candidates were debating each other on live television. You know, today it's a commonplace, but in those days, This is what the television monitor would look like in those days. I found some old pictures, put them together, and believe it or not, this guy is Kennedy, and this guy is Nixon, looks young, right? And in case you don't remember who this guy is, anybody remember him?
Khrushchev.
President Khrushchev. He was the one who came to the United States and sat in the United Nations and took his shoe and started banging on the table. If you hear about that, that's a fact. I heard about it on the day it happened. I was in this country, and he was pretty mad, and he was fighting with the United States. Well, that's a side business. But the main debate is between these two. And how is this debate and this politics connected with what the scientists wanted to do? Okay? Well, there is a big connection between science and politics. Yes. Next slide. JFK era. In addressing the joint session of the Congress, I think this was done in May of that year, after his inauguration. By the way, Kennedy won. You all know that, right? You just read history. But did you know that Kennedy did not win with a landslide victory? He just barely won. You know. That's how Nixon came back, and he won afterwards, after Kennedy was killed and all that. And then Lyndon Johnson became, and then you can read all about that in history. But as far as I'm concerned, what happened was, by the way, this is Lyndon Johnson, and that's Kennedy. And at the joint session, he was quite upset, although the paper wouldn't say that, but he was quite upset that the Russians were getting ahead of the United States and they sent the Sputnik. And the thing that they didn't want to tell everybody was when they tried to send their own kind of a Sputnik, it didn't go too far. It just went and came right back and fell on his face. And so America was terrible. They just didn't like that, so they wanted to do something. And so Kennedy, in the joint session in May, he said, no, he made a promise. And I would like to show you the next slide, where he made the following promise. I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the earth. So said President John F. Kennedy on May 25th, 1961. This is an actual quote from his speech. Well, I don't want to comment about why he said, I want to send a man to the moon. He should have said, I want to send a person to the moon. That's in the present context, politically incorrect, but then acceptable in those days. So times change. So he made the decision that we want to send a man to the moon. All right? And then, that's it. He took away all the money from everybody and put it into NASA. NASA was already there, but then it had to be strengthened, and then the next 10 years were spent. Although he died prematurely, somebody shot and killed him, but the program went ahead, and because NASA was strengthened and we were not going down to see what's happening, but we were going out. So our direction has changed 180 degrees. Instead of going down, we're going out. Okay, now, next slide. Yeah, we landed 1 year ahead of time. This was a great achievement. One step for mankind, whatever the saying, I didn't want to copy it, but you all know what it is. So they landed on the moon, and everything was wonderful. But they didn't stop there. If you see what happened next. By the way, this was 250,000 miles away. And the hole that they were going to drill, called the Mohole, was only 5 kilometers away. So where is 250,000 miles, 250,000 miles, and where is 5 kilometers? They didn't want to do this. They couldn't do it because of technological problems in those days, but today everybody does it. But they went to the moon, and then the next thing, Oh yeah, they went to other planetary bodies. Okay, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, they're still going. Okay, but what's being done to know what's going on under our own feet? Not much, unfortunately. Not very much. They're still drilling, but they're trying to see if they can go a little bit deeper. And meanwhile, there are gold mines in India and gold mines in Africa. The gold mines in India are the deepest mines in the world. Not because I come from that country, but they are, really. They are the deepest world in the world. And the depth is about 10,000 feet below the surface. 10,000 is 2 miles, a little bit less than 2 miles. So that's already gone. And to the center of the Earth, well, I don't know if I should tell you what is the center of the Earth, approximately 4,000 miles. So I tell my students, two down and only 3,998 more to go to reach the center. Then we'll be there. But meanwhile, we're going, we're going up. Okay, next slide. While we are going this way, the Russians, they're very quiet guys. They don't keep quiet. So they always want to be number one. And so they started drilling down. And they have the deepest hole as of today in Siberia. This hole is approximately 12 kilometers down from the surface, around 8 miles, 9 miles. Maybe now it's a little bit more. But the Russians, they were the first to send Sputnik. But then Kennedy said, no, they can't be first. We got to be first. So we landed on the moon first. And then we were going further. But meanwhile, these guys going drill. So they are first now, okay? So somebody is to, when they find out this, they're going to say, oh no, now we're going to go to the center of the Earth by drilling. I don't know. I hope they will do something. Next. What does all this mean to us? What we really want to know is what is underneath, inside the Earth. The mantle, we don't know. And if we go to the core, we don't know. The outer core, the inner core, all these things, we really don't know. We've never been there. But every textbook will tell you that the inner core and the outer core is made up of nickel, iron, and all that, as if they have been there. Baloney. They didn't go there. They're just right. Because somebody told them. Okay. Where did they get that information? Well, somebody determined the density by indirect methods. These geophysicists, they can do calculations and said, oh, it's very dense. And so somebody said, how dense? Oh, it's very heavy. How heavy? Oh, maybe like iron. Oh yeah, where is the iron? Oh, you go to the Museum of Natural History and we got meteorites like this. And they said, well, yeah, this maybe this is down there. Not really, I'm just making a story. But in reality, there are theories that the Earth and the solar system have the same general composition when they started. And then the Earth differentiated, meaning that the lighter material came up, the heavier material sank to the bottom, and that's how we know that the Earth is layered. All this layering is because of differentiation. And when we look at the compositions or the densities of materials, we find that they have to be very heavy, and meteorites come from outer space. And so if we have analogy between the Earth and meteorites, maybe this is the kind of material that's inside. Maybe. Most textbooks will write you saying that, yes, iron, as though they have been there. No, they haven't. Okay? Next one. And then we find all kinds of things happening on the Earth, like earthquakes. This, I took this picture from the earthquake in Kobe not too long ago. You can see what happened to the highway. The highway got twisted, and all the cars went down, and it's a terrible thing. Earthquakes. If we try to look at where are the earthquakes around the world, next slide, we'll find that there they are. These are all the locations for the earthquakes. Some big, some small, but generally this is where you find them. Okay. Next, we also have volcanoes. Here is a volcano from Italy. Vesuvius is something that you have heard of in a place called Sorrento, near Naples, south of Rome. If you go to Italy, make sure this is beautiful to look at. You should see these volcanoes. And if you wonder how many volcanoes are there and where are they, the next slide will show you an idea of where all the volcanoes are. You know, these are all volcanoes. Every triangle is a volcano, the volcano, volcano. As a matter of fact, they're all around the Pacific. So we call the Pacific as the Ring of Fire. That's a nickname given by people, geologists, they like that. And there's a little bit of a Ring of Fire right smack in the middle of the Pacific. And do I have to tell you the name of the nice, wonderful place? Hawaii. That's the one in the center, in the Ring of the Fire. Next one. The interesting thing is, if you superimpose the locations of the earthquakes and the volcanoes, this is what we get. Earthquakes and volcanoes together, you can see they are more or less on top of each other. Wherever there is an earthquake, there's a volcano, more or less. Not always there, but if there is a volcano, definitely there is an earthquake. But if there is an earthquake, it may or may not have a volcano. But if you gather all the information around the world and plot it, this is what you get. And this tells us something as to what's happening to the world. There are zones. These are the zones along which there are weaknesses. You remember the first slide I put up where things are going apart and combining and all that? That's where it's happening. This is the idea that was proposed, not at the very beginning. In the very beginning, they didn't know, but they said, look here, these two things look alike, these things look like they're the same, there are glaciers here, there are glaciers there, there are animals here, there are animals there, they can't swim. These are the kinds of proposals that were made to support the idea of continental drift. But then all this came to light. I mean, the volcanoes were always there, the earthquakes were always there, but the idea of combining them and seeing what they mean to us came to us only in the 1960s. Early 60s is the time when this whole idea was put together, and the new name, plate tectonics, was proposed. Next slide. You can see that the Earth is broken up into various different plates. And a plate is nothing but a piece of the Earth. This piece of the Earth may be either continent or ocean. It doesn't matter because the Earth is all one. You just take the water out, like I showed you originally. When you take the water out, it's all land. And so a plate is part ocean, part land. Or maybe all ocean, maybe all land, it doesn't matter. The part that behaves as one piece, and that one piece moves in whatever direction that something is telling it to move. So, when they try to connect all these earthquakes and volcanoes, they come up with these boundaries, and these are plate boundaries. Again, we're back into the boundary business. We started talking about political boundaries, ethnic boundaries, geologic boundaries. Now we have plate boundaries. So, using these boundaries, and by the way, on a real globe, that's what it looks like. And next one. On a colored map, so it'll impress you, you can see the entire Pacific is Pacific plate, and then there's the Indian plate, and then there's the South American plate, there's the North American plate. By the way, just to give you an idea of where these plates start and end, these are all earthquake and volcanic zones. And in the middle of the Atlantic is this zone of hills, and valleys, and so the plate, the North American plate, goes from the middle of the Atlantic to the western edge of the United States. The plate does not stop simply because land stopped and the water took over. That doesn't mean anything to the plate. The plate goes from here to here. Similarly, the South American plate goes from this edge, which is the western edge of South America, to the middle of the Atlantic. Okay, next one. There are different kinds of plate motions I talked about. The motion could be going apart from each other, or they could be going toward each other. This is the kind of a movement I talked between India and China, and this is the kind of a movement in that part of the world. And then if you go to the California side, we have this kind of a movement where one plate is moving sideways, the other one is moving the other way. This is not going away from each other, nor going toward each other, it's going sideways. This is called a different kind of a plate boundary. There are basically three different kinds of boundaries of these plates, the movements. Let's go to the next slide. The same picture, show you a little bit more detail of the divergent plate boundary. That means things are being pulled apart. This is what's happening in the middle of the Atlantic. And so there are volcanoes coming up. And if it gets pulled up a little bit more, more volcanoes, pulled up a little bit more, more volcanoes, so that you can see the youngest volcano is right smack in the center. And as you go away from the center, it gets older and older volcanoes. All right. And that's the general way in which the entire Atlantic is built up. All right, next slide. The convergent plate boundary, where things are hitting each other, this is where it's going to happen. This is an example in South America, where one plate is going under, the other plate is riding over, because they are hitting each other. There are two or three different ways in which this collision can happen. This is one of them. And as this one goes down, it gets hot, and then there's magma that is generated, and then it gets mixed up and then comes up as a volcano. This is the surface, and this is the story of the Andes Mountains. All these are manufactured in this fashion. Okay. In the case of China and India, there's nothing going down or up. They're just colliding with each other, and there's nothing. When they collide with each other, instead of going like this, they just go like this. You know, collide, and then go. That's how Himalayas are built up. Next one. And then this is the third kind of a movement, transform fault. This is what happens in California, where we have one plate moving north, the other plate moving south. Next slide. I just wanted to show you California there, and the movements are along the San Andreas Fault, and this is a real picture of the San Andreas Fault from the air. You can see that things are being broken up. There's a river that is, you know, broken up because of the faulting, and it's unfortunate that things are happening there, but people still like California. You are moving too? Make sure that you know the geology before you move, so that you can be forewarned as to what you're getting into. Next. And then if you go to the bottom of the ocean, there are wonderful things called the black smokers. And these are very very economically important, because they got more good mineral deposits and all that. These have been discovered only more recently, within the last 10 years or so. If you go to the Museum of Natural History, they have a real one that they dug up from the ocean and then brought it and put it there in the Earth History Hall. They spent millions of dollars making that exhibit. And by the way, they also have a globe, and you can lie down there and watch the globe, and then all the ocean water will disappear, and then you can see the bottom of the ocean, and then the water will come back up. It's all there. It's just that if you walk around, you won't see all this. You have to take it easy, take your time, and then all these good things will happen. So, There is the black smoker from the bottom of the ocean. Next one.
The round thing, is that a coin or is that?
Go back. Could you go back? No, it's a number they put on it. They were trying to, when they describe it, number three or something like that. It's nothing to do with it. This is the probe that they were trying to sample. They have a probe trying to sample it. Okay, next one. Around the world, if you put all this information together, that things are moving away from each other. This is the mid-Atlantic. And things are going toward each other, like over here. This one is going down and this one is going up. And then the third one is not shown here, where the things are going sideways. So we put it all together and say that the crust, the mantle, and the core, the outer core and the inner core. And then why are these things moving? Well, we believe that there are convection currents. What we mean by convection currents are things that move if you have a boiling water. The heat is from below and it gets hot and then it's transmitted toward the top, so things move this way. And that's exactly what's happening in the Earth, because it's very hot inside, it's not that hot outside, so things keep swelling up and moving. And this kind of a movement is called the convection. And how fast does this move? Well, it's very slow, maybe a couple of centimeters per year. If it is going 5 or 6 centimeters per year, it's very fast. So in a lifetime, you may not see it. But if you really want to see plates moving, go to Iceland. That is right smack on top of the mid-Atlantic ridge. And Iceland, you can see things happening all the time. Only thing is, you got to take up citizenship and live there and watch. And as the land, you know, increases, you got new land being created. So I tell my students, if you want to go into real estate business, you go to Iceland and you buy yourself a small plot and you wait there a couple of 100 years, and then it will become bigger and bigger and bigger, and you get more money. Next. And then finally, Hawaii. How can we leave Hawaii? You remember I showed you Hawaii in the center? I know we are going over time, but we'll finish up in the next 5 minutes. Hawaii is a very interesting story, because it doesn't fit with any of the previous theories. They're either going back or going toward each other, going hitting each other, or so going sideways. Nothing. Nothing happened. Right smack in the middle of the ocean, there's a boom. There's a volcano. How can we explain this? So people gone round and round, and they try to explain that, no, there is a very hot spot down inside the Earth. Because it's hot, they call it hot spot. Very good name, right? Because it's hot, it's hot spot. From the hot spot, we get magma coming up. And this magma coming up is called the plume, all right? So, and then the plume comes and hits the surface of the Earth, and then there's a volcano. And that's exactly what happens in all these islands. Only thing is, if you look at how old these rocks are, you'll find that there's a very interesting thing coming up. Right now, this is the big island, which is erupting, which has been erupting within the last 400,000 years. Forget about the 400,000. In the last 10 years, 20 years that I've been alive, I've been there, and it's erupting. So that's recent. And then if we go to the next island, it's about 1.3 million years. The next one is about 1.8 million years. Then we got 3 million years, and then 5 million years. So the age of these rocks, by the way, all these are dead volcanoes, and this is the only live one now. So what's happening is that there was a volcano there, there's another volcano, another volcano, another volcano, and this is the most recent one, and all these are dead and gone, and this one is alive. What that means is that basically, I told you there is this hot spot, and there is this connection, and then there is a plate, and the plate moves. First, the volcano is over here, the plate is over here. Then the plate moves, the volcano is over here. The plate moves, the volcano is over here. The plate moves, the volcano is over here. So the plate is moving, but this damn thing is sitting tight. That hot spot is anchored in the mantle. That is not moving, but the plate is moving. So all these ages tell us which way the plate is moving, and we know that, yep, the plate is moving. Next slide. Not only that, by the way, these are the Hawaiian Islands. This is the biggest island, which is the most recent one. And then this trend goes up till here, and then it takes a turn. And the ages are even older and older. That means this plate was not moving just in one direction, it has changed course. So we know things are not always happening the same way, but they do change in some fashion or the other. Next one. Yeah. We have just started to scratch the surface. We haven't even gone to the depth of 30 kilometers. But we've been to the moon. And I leave it to you to decide how much we know about the Earth. Not very much. Thank you very much. I'll be happy to answer any questions if you have. Can I have my coffee now? Yeah, yes, sir.
Is it much more difficult, like going deeper and deeper, like into the surface of the Earth?
You have this. There's nothing to stop you. Science is dependent upon money, and money is given by politicians. And if the politicians give us the money, yes, we can make things happen. That's how we went to the moon. We went to Mars. We went to Jupiter. We're going to Saturn. Money is the only one that is... You get the picture? When you become a millionaire, you just give us a few. We'll take care of it. Next time I'll tell you, and we go deeper with things.
Are there other hot spots than the one in the Atlantic Ocean?
There are some in Africa, and they're not as spectacular as this, but there are some. Yes, they're getting closer to it. That's a very good idea. I don't want to say they're hitting each other. They're right. Getting closer to each other. Yes.
Will like the surface go underneath?
No. They're, see the two plates, India and China, they have the same density. Mm-hmm. If they don't have the same density, the heavier plate will go down, the lighter plate will go up. But so they don't have the same density, so they just...
So will it form like a mountain or...
Yeah, Himalayas. They call them Himalayas, but correct pronunciation is Himalayas. Hima is snow. Alaya means temple. That's the true meaning of that word, the Sanskrit word, the temple of snow. Remember that, then you have Himalayas. Okay. Tibet, Bhutan. Kashmir, yeah, they're all Himalayas. And then it continues on to the other side. It's a fascinating subject. I'm in love with geology. I love to talk about it. Most of the time, you have questions.
There is a news item in the New York Times, yeah, that talked about how they wanted to have a quick way to go to the core. You want to comment on that?
No comment. There's no quick way of going to the core. No. There are lots of problems. The problem is that as you go deeper and deeper, it gets very, very hot. And even if you take the existing mines, you know, the deep mines in India, they're working at 10,000, 12,000 feet below surface, and the workmen cannot sustain themselves for more than about 20 minutes, 30 minutes a shift. So after 30 minutes, they got to come back to about 5,000 level and take rest, and then go back up. It's very difficult. The heat is the it's called a geothermal gradient. It's not the same everywhere. It's more in the oceanic areas than on the continental areas. And it's also more in some locations where there's more radioactivity and so on. But it's approximately 30 degrees centigrade per kilometer. Every kilometer you go down.
Per kilometer. As you go down, it gets hotter.
Yes. Except when you go into caves and caverns, that's a totally different story. You go into caves, it's nice and cool. My students ask me, how come it's, you go into your cave, it's going down, it's nice and cool, but you go into your mine, it's hot? Yes. Very easy to explain. In the caves, there are cracks and there is water vapor going through and all that, and that water, when it starts to evaporate, it absorbs the heat. Evaporation of water, if you know your physics, is a cooling process. Evaporation is a cooling process. So the water in the caves is evaporating, therefore it's taking away all the heat there. So it's cool. Whereas there's no water in these mines. It's dry. Besides, these mines are much deeper than the caves. The caves are only a few feet, maybe 100 feet, 200 feet maximum. The mines are much deeper. Yes, ma'am.
Is that the Russians drill the deepest hole? Do you know what?
I'm sorry. The Russians?
They have the deepest hole.
Yeah, they have not reached this, what we call Mohole. Mohole is called a discontinuity because the material above it is of one density, and below it is another density. There's a sharp density difference, so that when we send the earthquake waves suddenly go faster. And some Mohorovičić was his name. He discovered this long time ago. And so we call that boundary layer as the Mohorovičić discontinuity. And then Mohorovičić became too long, so we call him Moho. So Moho is a term that we use. And it tells us that there is a difference in material. And we're trying to still go through that Moho. We have not done it yet. And the Russians are still above Moho. There are lots of different countries which have tried. Like, for example, Sweden, about 15, 20 years ago, Sweden started drilling. And it seems some scientist, I can't remember his name, but he said, well, there is petroleum. If you drill into the earth. Well, why? It's because there is carbon there underneath. And if there is carbon and if there is some other bacteria, it'll make petroleum. So if you drill, I'll prove to you there is petroleum down there. So these guys put in a lot of money and drilled. But they couldn't find any petroleum. And they went, I think, about 5 kilometers. 6 kilometers depth, and then they said, no, this guy is useless. They stopped putting money into the hole. But they got a lot of information, what kind of rock and all that. The Russians are now doing it. They still find the same kind of rock that we know. Nothing special. To see that there's a big change in the density is what we're looking for. We haven't come to that yet.
But can you get information from, especially, say, exposed areas like the faults and right. Also volcanoes?
Yes, let me tell you that. The way we know about what's inside, through volcanoes and lava flows, if we look at the stuff that's being ejected, sometimes we find chunks of rock which don't look anything like the material that is being erupted by the volcano. We call this as xenoliths. xenoliths, X-E-N-O-L-I-T-H-S. Xenolith is the name because it looks different from the main rock. It's a Greek term. I don't know the language, but they tell me it's a Greek term. So when you look at the xenoliths, we find that they're different. And then we try to figure out what's the temperature and pressure at which these xenoliths were originally manufactured. We have methods by which we could determine the temperature and pressure of the formation of these. And we find that they are formed at very at depths, like maybe 30 kilometers or 40 kilometers depth, or 40 kilobars depth. And the temperatures are also about 2,000. When we come up with these kinds of numbers, we know that that's what the mantle is made up of. So this is an indirect evidence. Although it is direct in a sense, the direct would be if we actually go down there and pick a piece up and bring it. That will be the direct. But this, nature sent us up, free, no cost. We just have to go and pick it up. And the same thing happened. Instead of sending it up from the mantle, sent it from other planets. That's the iron stuff. And also some meteorites. The meteorites are made up of a lot of olivine and pyroxene. That's the lighter stuff. And then they're also made up of iron. These are the two different kinds of materials. So one kind is accounted for by these nodules or xenoliths. And so the other kind should be inside. I mean, this is all theorization. But we have not gone beyond 12 kilometers. We still have a lot more to go before we know. That's why my last slides, we just barely scratched the surface.
Yeah. At the way Russia is going, how long will it take for them to reach the core?
It's very hard to say. Because even under normal surface conditions, if you drill maybe 10 feet, 20 feet, 30 feet per day, it's very good progress. But as you go deeper and deeper, it gets harder, it's more difficult, and then by the time you put the drill hole and then pull up the core, and then put the drill hole back again, I don't know the timing. I don't want to venture. I don't think we'll be able to see anything from underneath before my time is up. Maybe you, the future scientists, you should be able to take the challenge and do it.
So the xenolith is part of the mantle.
That's right. And it's been picked up by the basalt that was traveling up.
About 1,000 miles down.
No, about 40 kilometers, 50 kilometers, 100 kilometers. This is the approximate depths. Maybe 200 kilometers, or maybe 300. But you see, most of this stuff that
we... Is this part of the plate?
No. This is not part of the plate. The plate is only the uppermost, approximately 100 kilometers thickness. And that is behaving in a brittle fashion, right? This brittle plate is moving in one piece. And then what is it moving on? It's moving on what we call a asthenosphere, which is a little bit weaker zone. The weaker zone is like on a hot summer day, if you're traveling in your car on a tar surface, it's gooey, a little bit gooey. And the car is sliding on top. And that's exactly what's happening. The plate is solid. It is not, you know, it's coherent. It's moving on top of the asthenosphere. That's the theory we have. But we have not gone to see the asthenosphere yet. We have not even gone to see the bottom of the crust yet. All this is based on indirect evidence. Seismology is very important for us because they're the ones who tell us everything. They tell us the speed, and then we give them the rock, and they test it and say, yeah, this rock can go with this speed. So they match up, And then we look at it and say, yeah, that's a possibility. And then we try to match it with the xenoliths and all that.
And that seismologist is like, they are situated all over?
Oh yeah, they're everywhere.
So if there's an earthquake like the one in Algeria,
they pick it up.
Everybody would know about it before they calculate that.
You see, the way they do that is, they need data. There are seismology stations all over the world. And they need the data from three different locations in order to fix the actual location where the earthquake started. The two things. One is called the epicenter, what's on the surface. This is where everybody thinks the earthquake started. But in reality, the earthquake really started underneath the surface, a certain distance. And that's called the focus. So the real location where the earthquake started is the focus, but then everybody thinks in terms of the epicenter, which is directly on top. And to have that location, we need three stations. And each station can record when the earthquake hit that location from here or from there. The farther it is, the more time it takes for this wave to travel. So depending upon how far away it is, the time taken is different. So what they do is they calculate the distance, and then they draw circles from that for that distance, and where all the three circles meet, that's the location. And then from there they do the rest of the calculation. It's a very interesting subject. Geophysicists, that's why I said they're our good friends. They always tell us the right thing. But funny thing is, they can't tell us what rock it is. So we have to give it. They say this is the speed. Okay? Yeah. So what rock is it? We don't know. You tell us. Oh, here, I have this rock, I have this rock, I have this rock. You go test it in your lab and tell me which rock fits this speed. So they go and test it. And then they bring back this rock. Oh, yeah. Looks like it's okay. So this is the rock we have. It's like one geophysicist, it seems, was trying to figure out what the moon is made up of. And so they have this seismic information. And so he was testing the seismic information on different kinds of rocks. And then he found that the speed is okay with green cheese. So he came to the conclusion the moon is made up of green cheese. This is just a joke because they don't know. They're only looking at whatever material somebody gives them to test. And if the speed is matched by the speed in this material, they say, yeah, that's the material. And then somebody said, it's green cheese, man. I mean, it's not rock. Well, I don't know. You tell me. So next time when somebody went to the moon, then they picked up a rock and then they brought it. And then we looked and said, oh, yeah, we have this. I worked on all the missions. The lunar missions, and it was very interesting. It was about 10 years or so. Yeah. It was enjoyable.
It's more expensive than gold.
Yeah, right. They don't even allow everybody to have pieces of the moon. They're all government property. They don't allow anybody to own one. That's why recently Sotheby's tried to auction a piece of the moon. They didn't make it.
One more question. In terms of that ring of fire,
yeah.
What does that tell us in terms of, say...
It simply tells us that the zone of weakness... See, the ring of fire is nothing but a zone of weakness. There are earthquakes and volcanoes all around the Pacific. And they're all subduction zones, meaning that they're one going under, the other one going over. And all around the Pacific, things are going under and they're going over. So
why is it not the case on the other side?
Well, that's why I said the Earth is finite. The size of the Earth is finite. It's not expanding or contracting. If it is, very little. But then these things which are moving on top, they're moving on the surface. And if this thing is moving this way and this thing is moving this way, you've got to go collide somewhere. You can't just keep going, going, going. It's not flat. So that's how we have this. And then we have different places, each one is moving in a different fashion, so it's collision zones all over the place.
Okay. When was that discovered, that pattern of what you...
All this came to light about late 50s, early 60s was the time when we knew about volcanoes, we knew about earthquakes for as long as people have been undergoing this. But how did they connect this to make this theory? This happened when, for the first time, when they were digging samples from the middle of the Pacific, Atlantic Ocean, they found that the rocks in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean were young. Time-wise, they're quite young. They're only 60 million years, or 40 million years, or maybe 10 million years. Whereas on the continents, they're quite old. So there's a professor in Princeton University, a fellow by the name Harry Hess, and he first discovered this, I think, because he said, how could it be? How could the oceans be young and the continents be old? Doesn't make sense. So he didn't write a paper immediately. He gave a presidential address, I think in 1960, or 1560, I think, the Geological Society of America, saying that this is geopoetry. He called it geopoetry. He didn't call it by any other name. He said, the oceans are young, the continents are old, there's something going on, and this is like geopoetry. I'm writing poetry. And then there were a couple of students. One came from England, another one was American. So they both started thinking about it. And then they started looking at magnetic maps that were produced in the Atlantic. They made a lot of magnetic maps, but they didn't understand what all these magnetic maps meant. They made the maps. They looked like stripes. Don't know, put it away. And then when this thing started to grow, the whole idea, then they pulled those things back and said, now we can make sense. Because as more and more lavas are coming in, and each of these new lavas have magnetization in a certain orientation. Some are oriented this way, some are oriented the other way, and absolutely symmetrical. It's like a mirror image. There are very nice pictures. You can see mirror images in the oceans. Then this whole new theory came up. And all this happened in the 60s, early 60s. And when I went to school, I didn't learn all this. It's just continents breaking up, like the original slide I showed you, just things are going. But the idea is the same, but why is it happening? The theories are different. Okay? I see they're all getting anxious to go home. You should let them go. Thank you very much for listening to this talk. I hope